If you listen very closely to what I'm about to share, you will no longer have any excuses. Because of today's artificial intelligence, you can literally take your dreams and make them a reality. Now, unfortunately, that's not the sentiment, that's not the sort of perspective that you listen to from the experts or in many of the conferences that you attend on artificial intelligence. They tend to focus on the limitations and the problems, the things artificial intelligence can't do and shouldn't do. And this frustrates me. I was at a conference about 2 months ago, and literally the whole conference was spent about talking about what the things AI can't do. All of the challenges, all of the problems. It can't do this, it can't do that. So I went straight home, jumped onto the aeroplane, really looking forward to get home. Now on the plane, I put my headphones on as I was going to my seat. Super excited to just chill out and forget about that day full of negativity. As I approached my seat, 27D, my heart sank. There was a woman sat on the seat right next to me, and she looked like a talker. I'm not a talker. I'm one of those people that on a plane, I just want to be by myself, go into my zone. But the challenging thing about this woman, she was an older black woman. She looked, she was a grandmother. Short, white hair, glasses very similar to mine, and a beautiful smile. And it was just one of those people that you can't ignore. The sort of person who looks like they can give you a hug and make you feel better. But man, was I right. From the moment I sat down, she talked. Till the time we landed, she talked. She kept talking. I took my laptop out to try and look like I'm working, and she kept talking. I closed my eyes and pretended to be asleep, and she nudged me and continued talking. She told me about her grandchildren and how they're learning how to ride a bike, things that I thought were a little irrelevant at the time, and I was just nodding. She told me how she loved to bake chocolate cake for them and the process of actually making the cake. But it wasn't until she started a particular conversation that I paid a little bit more attention. She started to talk about her husband. And of course, she talked about her husband very fondly. He's a farmer. But more specifically, she started to talk about this ring that he had had made for her. And she was, you know, the ring looked amazing. It looked pretty complex, a feat of engineering. Now, I'm not a jeweler. I'm not one of those sort of people, so it wasn't my cup of tea. But when I saw the ring, the very first thing I asked her was, is your husband an engineer or a jeweler or something with those sort of expertise? She said, no, he's a farmer, but he has a way with words. It was at that exact moment that I realized something pretty profound. You know when someone says something to you and it just sticks deep and it hits really hard? And I realized that language is the cornerstone of creation. And literally, you can speak things into existence just with the things that you say, the things that you can manage, any product, any service. And you know what? That stuck with me for a while. I wasn't going to take a selfie with this old lady. Her name was Betty, by the way. And I wasn't going to take a selfie with her because I thought that's a bit weird. I'm not a picture guy, I'm not a talker, I'm just not one of those individuals. But you know what? True to my word, I took my language, my description of her, and I put that into ChatGPT. And this is Betty. Believe it or not, this is Betty. This is what Betty looks like. It really shows you the power of language today with generative AI, or what they call large language models. You can literally create anything. Any dream, any goal, any desire you have can be brought about by language. I like to look at it as a really simple analogy of being able to get from your imagination to reality. It's a tool that we can use to cross that bridge. It's a tool that we can use to take anything that sits in our mind and make it real. Now, when I said tool, one of the things that came to my mind straight away was something that Steve Jobs said. It's an anecdote that he often refers to. He talks about a study that was taking place in the US where they were looking at how efficient animals, people, and machines are getting from A to B, how energy efficient they are, and they ranked them. Human beings ended up somewhere, you know, like a third down the list, so we weren't doing very well at all in terms of our energy efficiency from getting to A to B. But at the very top of the list was a condor. It's a bird from South America. It's massive, by the way. It's huge. It's bigger than the average human. It's definitely bigger than me, right? Massive bird, but it's the most efficient from getting from A to B. And Steve Jobs goes on to say that someone had the ingenuity and the genius to test how energy efficient are we if you put a man on a bicycle. And that was through the scale, higher, way higher than the Condor, right? Significantly higher. And it really shows that some of the tools that we build transform the human experience. And we as humans are tool builders. They amplify a lot of existing inherent ability. So now think about generative AI. If language is the cornerstone of creation, it's able to supercharge every single process, every single step in the creation journey. But we're not going to realize this unless we get rid of a couple of behaviors and a couple of perspectives. The first one I have to address is the one that everybody talks about, fear. And one in particular, I was talking about this to a friend who's an artist. And she said to me, well, then what happens to the artist? And she's right. And so it's worth us talking about it, right? What happens to the artist? What happens to the writer? What happens to the developer if AI can do all of these sort of things? And a real analogy that came to mind, something that really brought this home for me, was, of course, because she's an artist, was I started to think about what art was in the past. You see, in the past, what I understand that art was almost a form of mimicry. We could take illustrations of the real world. We drew pictures of churches, pictures of bridges, pictures of people. But then the camera came, and the camera changed everything. But it's because of the camera that we got impressionist art. We got some of the surreal art like we can see there from Dali. And what that says to me is that, yes, things will change. But the artist didn't disappear. Their role changed. And interestingly enough, the artist became more human, tapped into more of their emotional side of things rather than the robotic side of things. And so from that, I remember talking to her and I said, listen, you shouldn't worry about this, right? We've got things in our armory that are going to enable us to be different and going to enable us to change. Where the machine has tactics, we still have strategy. We can come up with goals and objectives. Where the machine can calculate the probability of something, we still have intuition. I have three kids, that mother's intuition that your kid is gonna fall over, right? Where the machine has memory and can literally store things that have happened factually, we have experience. So that's one thing we've got to do. We've got to remove that worry and understand that. But just by being human, there is more that we can do. Our roles will change for the better. And in fact, one of those roles, one of those statements that I'll leave with you is, we've got to take the robot out of the human. And that's exactly what this is saying. Delegate those tasks that the robot can do, the machine can do very, very well, and spend time being a human being. The other thing that gets in our way, that we perhaps aren't so attentive to and aren't realizing, is that even as human beings, we are becoming more and scarily more like the machines that we have designed to serve us. You know, and there's three areas in which I will show you that particular perspective. The first one is overconsumption, right? We spend so much time consuming products, information, and less time creating. When we spend so much time on consumption, creation takes a back seat. The balance that we have between the time spent on consuming, the time we spend on creating, is completely wrong. And actually, the machine is so much better than us at consuming information. It can do that way better than we can. In fact, something else I found last night as I was preparing for this talk. Did you know that in the UK, we consume more food and cooking-related programs than we spend time cooking? Right? So we've got this balance completely wrong. The other thing is that we are obsessed with efficiency and functionality. Every startup founder or every startup book is talking about reduce friction, remove friction, make it easier, make it really simple to do. You know, not knowing that us as humans inherently value a little bit of effort. But the machine is all about minimized input, maximized output. And that's some of the things that we're focusing on. Sounds very much like a machine. And the third thing is these are dark times. There's a lot of pessimism going around. And when you're pessimistic, you lose your growth mindset. You become really rigid in your thought process. You lose adaptability. And that's very, very mechanic and machine-like. So those are the things that are in the way. Things will change, but they'll inherently make us more human. We've got to get rid of this pessimistic view. We've got to get rid of overconsumption and focus a bit more on creation. And all of these things are what's going to get in the way for us. But listen, the barriers are being removed, right? And this is a really, really big part of this. In order for us to realize our dreams with artificial intelligence and working together, you've got to understand that this ability to create is no longer down to the experts. The barriers have gone. You don't need to be an expert designer. If we look back at the aeroplane, it wasn't designed or created by aeronautical engineers. The barriers have gone. Betty's husband, if you remember Betty from earlier, created this ring, and he's a farmer. He didn't have to be an expert designer. Literally anything you have. But why is this so important for you? It's important because we need to understand that if expertise is going out to the edge, typically change comes from the edge. How many vaccines were created by people who weren't vaccine experts? So many things. So really what that says to me is that in order for us to experience this, it's up to you. Because there are no more excuses. So I took that challenge on, and I said, hey, as I was talking to my wife, trying to explain this ring and trying to describe this ring to her. And I did the same thing that I would naturally do. I went back to ChatGPT. Oh my gosh, I got it. This was the ring, right? I'm super excited because it was really hard to describe. Like I said, not my cup of tea, but it was one of those weird feats of engineering. It looked to me like it could move. And I was so excited when I was able to put this together. So remember, creation is going to be up to you because change comes from the edge. But when you're creating, please remember empathy. Empathy is a really, really important thing. It's the entrepreneur's supercharger, if you like. It's a way that you can see and find opportunities that you didn't know before because you begin to form an intimate relationship with the person or the thing that has the problem or the challenge. There's a great example about a cake mix that was made, I think, in the 60s. I may have got that wrong. And this cake mix basically allowed you to make cake by just adding water. So it took away all the friction, and it was focused on functionality, and people didn't like it. So you know what they did? They took out the egg mix, and they forced you to beat an egg and then add water, and more people bought it. But you can see the process of creating a cake involves emotion. There's things and people we care about typically when we're making it. And the last thing we'll talk about here when we talked about pessimism is optimism. There's a fantastic study that was done in the US looking, it was a longitudinal study, and looking at the most successful people, see if they could find traits about people who are successful. And the one thing they found was those that were successful were naturally optimistic. They described them as having unrealistic goals and objectives. I don't call it unrealistic goals and objectives. It means they were willing to dream. And the last thing is, they were able to always find a way. So this story started with Betty, who I met on the plane. As you can see, she's one of those where you just can't ignore that smile. I met up with her son. We went for a beer, and we started having a conversation. And I said, listen, how's Betty doing? And he said, not too good. It looks like she's struggling with her memory. She may be showing some signs, early signs of Alzheimer's. But what really struck me, and it'll struck you too, was the words that he used to explain that. So he said, she never forgot anyone's birthday. She never forgot to cheer him from the sidelines when he was playing football. She never forgot to pack a special treat in his lunchbox. She never forgot to listen and hear the unspoken words. She never forgot to smile. But one day she will forget his birthday. And one day she will forget his name. And one day, he said, she'll forget that I'm Matt, her son. And his mom deserves to be remembered. So why am I telling you this story? because we talked about creation and we almost tend to limit our thoughts to products and services. But we can create moments, we can create memories, we can create emotional spaces. Our systems are so broken. When she went for the tests, it took 6 weeks for them to get back to her with the results. And all the doctors were focused on was the functional aspect of doing the test and coming back with the result. Nobody took time to try and support the family through this difficult time, give them information, how to prepare, what to do, how to deal with what they're thinking. None of that was made available to them. But when you have empathy, you can see some of these challenges. We uploaded a lot of PDFs around this disease into ChatGPT so that Matt and his family could be able to ask questions and get some of the answers that nobody else was willing to provide. So again, if you've listened to what I've shared very carefully, you will no longer have an excuse. Creation is going to be up to you because change comes from the edge. Please go with empathy and with optimism, you will find a way. It'll mean so much to me, it'll mean so much to Betty, and it'll mean so much to society if you go out and create. Thank you.